Welcome back to Hanging Out with Ron.
Hey guys, so we're going to flip the script here, right?
Thanks
and
for having
I get
us
to
on.
interview you because you guys are coming from illustration and you wanted to know about fine art and the work I do for the U.S. Mint, and I'm coming from that background and getting back into illustration and wanting to know about the possibility of expanding my income stream by getting into conventions, which is where I met the two of you. It was at Dragon Con this year. So if you're up for it, I got some questions to ask you so that I'm going to know everything to do next year to get into conventions and make boatloads of cash.
You should get into the next year. There's only one way to do it. You got to jump in.
I got to jump in. So we talked a little bit about this and where I'm located and where you're located. But if I wanted to get into conventions that were I was the most likely to make sales and profit at, which conventions in the Eastern United States would you recommend?
That's a tough, I mean, there nothing's black and white, right? Because most likely to make sales means so many different things to so many different people.
Different demographics, right? Like, yeah. You know, what would you describe your body of work that you're likely to be taking to these conventions?
If I'm doing fantasy figurative illustration,
okay, so there can, okay, I would apply for Gen Con no matter what, because Gen Con is just pure population. There's nothing weird about it. It's in a big convention hall. You're set up with a booth. They even give you walls if you can get in. It is a juried show. It's got a high price point at like 600, was it 600 something dollars, although you can get a smaller booth.
It's like a $400 option and a $600 option, depending on the table size that you're getting. It is a gaming, specifically a tabletop gaming convention, so things that you can do to angle yourself towards that market may pay off.
That's actually why I said Gen Con. When you say figurative, there you'll never have so many art directors come talk to you. I mean, usually from small presses, but when you're at Gen Con, I'd say like five people a day come up and try and offer me work.
And this year there were at least four art directors from Wizards of the Coast who were there. Two from D&D and two from Magic the Gathering. So yeah, you get some high caliber art directors coming through for the gaming industry at that one.
And you're getting, what did they say? I think on the news, it was something like it doubles the population of downtown Indianapolis for a weekend. I mean, it's just tons of people.
It's maybe like 80,000 people or something like that.
I've been there once, and I think it was 60 to 65,000, I think, when I was there.
It's been growing year on year for most years.
Yeah, they probably just take daily tickets and add them all together.
Well, they have badges associated. Yeah. Like, in order to get into that show, you have to have an account on GenCon.com.
Right.
And a badge associated with your name. So they know exactly how many badges for how many people, like, they've given out.
I just say, what's news said, so, man.
I have heard from some other artists that Gen Con was one of their top selling conventions that they go to. And you seem to be thinking the same way. But again, depending on the type of work you're selling. Dragon Con is, I heard similar things, that was for a lot of people one of their top two. Gen Con and Dragon Con were both.
Dragon Con's a strange show. I wouldn't advise anybody to go to Dragon Con for their first convention because it's such an outlier. Anywhere else, you're going to basically go to a big convention hall. You're going to get a table. And I'd say like...
Well, some parts of Dragon Con follow that logic. It depends on... See, they have their behind-the-scenes curation of... The people running it will look at your application and be like, oh, well, your work belongs in the fine art group, or it belongs in the pop art group, or you know, you're selling a lot of non-art product, then maybe you're going to be shunted towards the vendor hall.
So they decide where you get set up rather than you...
You can apply to whichever one of the ones you want to apply to, but they will judge for themselves and be like, oh, no, this is not the right track for you. We're going to send you over to this other track. So you have a little less agency over where you actually end up.
Whereas most other shows, it's vendors and then they have an artist alley.
Yeah.
Or an author alley or something.
I know IX is like that. You can either apply to, you know, the main hall fine art show, or you can get into the other deal of the hotel, you know, showcase. And I've heard people talk about pros and cons of both. I've heard for IX, if you want to sell, especially, you know, low priced items, prints, posters, cards, all that stuff, then that showcase is, or the, you know, the one over at the hotel is the way to go. If you want to be in the main art show, then that's all the original canvases and sculpture. And
well, you can find people like the main show is originals. Like it basically has to be. You might have some prints of said originals, but like the focus is absolutely on the originals there. I've heard from some fairly established artists who do a lot of original work though that the showcase can still be a good place for them. It just depends on how small a space you can fit into, because you've got a lot less space to work with at the showcase. You've got 1 6-foot table worth of space and maybe pro panels behind it or whatever to set up. But like if you were going to IX as a purely how much money can I make this weekend kind of proposition, I'd say the showcase is actually better than the main show for that. Main show, it's more like, okay, you want to get on the map with some of the top fantasy fine art collectors, and you want to make the absolute best case for yourself to those people, and or you've just got a ton of original work that you're looking to move, maybe because you're a magic or D&D artist and you've just got a bunch of those things that are related to what they're after, then, you know, the main show is a great place to actually be able to show all that and hopefully move it.
I've actually never been to IX, but I always heard, at least years ago, that it wasn't a place to make a lot of money unless you were in original sales. Is it still like that, or do you think it's exploded a
lot? I think that's still accurate. I think it's more a networking show than it is a sales show by far.
That's
what I think. But, you know, it's a networking show with a whole lot of artists, most of whom don't have a whole lot of budget for spending on stuff, right? So you have to think about that. But with a few high-end fantasy art collectors there. So again, it's like, okay,
and
do you want to establish a relationship with these people and hopefully be able to sell stuff for years to come? Then that's a good place to make your case for that. But it might be like an investment for the longer term, rather than I'm coming home with more than just paying for my time there.
Yeah, I've heard people say it's a great social time to get together with friends and hang out at the main show. And, and you know, if you want to go to some of the talks and maybe meet a few art directors, that's a kind of fun place to be. But if you get into the showcase, from what I've seen, that's only a few hours in the evenings. So you got the rest of the time to go and attend convention events and stuff. So it seems like all these... Pardon me. You submit to get in. Are all of these pretty much juried to get into?
No, only the best ones. You'll find that, like, Gen Con, Dragon Con. What other ones would be juried?
Emerald City, New York Comic Con, WonderCon, San Diego.
And usually you'll see the best art shows out of that, because people... and you see great sales because people know that they can expect quality. Whereas like I'm an advocate for Planet City Comic Con in Kansas City. I really like it, but there's been a lot of people that didn't do well. Bruce stopped going. I think partly because it was at the same time of another show though.
Yeah, it was around the same. I that was partly just the reshuffling of everything after the pandemic.
Yeah. So Planet City, you know, it's first come first serve. You as long as you're approved by Phil, who I think is a great guy who runs the art show, you're just in and you pay your money and you might show up by a person selling, you know, werewolf schoolgirl art. You never know.
So, yeah, and it's just a huge like air hanger worth of artist alley practically. So there's just tons and tons and tons of people in there. That's kind of like a standard experience for like a mid-tier Comic-Con type of a thing. But
Okay.
there's plenty of even like decent Comic-Cons and things like I'd say Denver and Salt Lake and so on are kind of similar operation, like less on the
Obviously,
jury and more on
if I'm in the eastern U.S., I'm in eastern Tennessee right
right.
now, and I can get to Gen Con, Dragon Con, and IX in
Yeah.
a half day's drive to all three.
Yeah.
Whereas going out to Kansas City or certainly Salt Lake or Denver, those
Right.
places,
Those would be
you've got a
flying
lot
shows.
further drive, and then you've got the transportation of all your goods and materials, so that adds to the cost. So what would you say is your average cost to all in to do a show?
If
Your
I'm
printing costs, your
driving,
travel costs, food, everything.
oh, food, I'm the wrong person to ask. I eat very well at
Like,
conventions.
yeah.
Sarek is getting
Alan's
on to
looking
me.
around for Michelin star
I am.
experiences.
Extra $500 a day for the food.
You're not wrong. My goal is to get away from congoers, so I, after a day of being at a convention, so I try and go to the fancy places.
Gotcha.
Usually I spend 2 grand before I even get there. That's when I'm not flying. And then you have to add in the cost of your goods,
Goods
and of course the
sold.
food. So
Yeah.
yeah, goods sold. And the
I
cost of your
usually
food, I'd throw in
figure
another grand.
Yeah, I usually figure mine's probably around 26 to 3,000, and not not counting how high the cost of goods sold could get when I have like a $10,000 show or a $15,000 show or something, right? Like the cost of goods sold creeps up as you're selling things, of course.
Well, that's what we're doing. I mean, when I
But
first
break-even
started,
point, yeah, is probably
so what's
26
your
to
average
three.
markup on over your cost to produce the printed materials? What do you
It's an extraordinary margin. For this
Depends on the
event,
item.
I buy mine from Elko Color Labs. They have a bulk pricing, so the price kind of changes depending on how
Well,
many you want to
it's
buy.
not depending on how many you buy
Or is
from
it the same
them.
price?
Yeah, it's the same price. They just set a minimum
Minimum
number that you have to order. It
of five.
has to be at least five of a particular image and
Yeah.
at least 15 prints in the order itself.
Okay, so I was thinking Printivity, which does change the price on,
Yeah.
when you go up. Then you, so we'll call it, what is that, like $2, $2 and something?
$3.
2.30? It's three?
Yeah,
Let's see,
it's like
that shows.
$2.97 now.
Yeah.
Something like that.
And then you have to add in the price for the board, which is basically negligible. I mean, I spend, what do I get?
Couple
Like,
cents.
yeah, a couple
10
cents.
cents, whatever.
The bag can be expensive. It's like $70 for 100 of these bags. You need to run your math on that. I'm bad. I'm an artist. Don't ask me what numbers. I'm kidding. I have this written
So,
down somewhere.
point being,
And then I
you're
sell them
buying them,
for.
yeah, $40,
I sell them
right?
for $40, buy two, get one free, and if everybody takes the
Oh.
deal, it lands it right at like $26.
Okay. So, I mean, obviously, you got to have a fairly decent markup just to cover all the costs involved and make a profit, but also you want to, there's a value to your work. What would
It's
you
a
say
luxury.
is kind of the sweet spot price-wise to sell at the conventions? What kind of range, like we talked about previously in the fine art side, 2,000 to 5,000 is a pretty common range for a lot of fine art. What's the range of cons?
Have different price buckets. You don't want to just put it all in on one and assume, okay, everyone's going to buy at this price range. What you really want is to have a range of items that are not stepping on each other. So not like, oh, small print for this price and medium size print for a little more and big print for a little more than that. Really, if you want those kind of price tiers, you want to have it be like, okay, well, I've got a pack of postcards and you don't get to necessarily pick which ones you want for, like your $10 or $15 or whatever. And then you've got your $40 main open edition print, and then you've got, $75 or $100 limited edition print maybe, or like a canvas print for hundreds of dollars, or and then originals and so on. So you kind of have this tiers for different people coming in, but also having those different tiers of prices helps to frame your pricing, right, in a kind of psychological way of, oh, you're selling this high-end item for $1,000. This $40 print seems like a very reasonable value.
Yeah, the big canvases that I sell, they are really there. I always view them as advertising cost more than product cost. Whenever I bring them, I know I just go expecting maybe I'm not going to sell them because,
Although you move them.
although I do move them, now I do think, oh, I'm going to sell these. But back when it was all fantasy and instead of my statues, I didn't. But anyway, so you've got the canvas up there for $500. You've got the second largest canvas for $250, and suddenly somebody who may have only thought, oh, I'll spend $20 on a print, that $40 starts to look like a deal because, well, it kind of is. But you have to frame them, get them into that mindset. It's why every restaurant sells steaks. If you start picking up on price framing, you notice it everywhere. It's like, oh, maybe shampoo's really good at it, things like that. You're like, oh, I'm
Starbucks, you've got your
Starbucks.
fancy everything in version, and you've got your basic cup of Joe, right? And that way you're also hitting people who have different mentalities around spending, right? Because you have your very price conscious people, and you've got people also who are less likely to buy something if it feels like it's too cheap. So you have to have something for different mindsets.
I would creep in on that though. I never had any luck selling something. Well, it may not work out for you if you have something at like $15, $20 competing with $40 prints, because it can be the case, and it was with Todd Lockwood's booth, that people would come up and they would always walk away with the $10, $15 print 9 times out of 10. So if you're going to do it, make it like a different kind of product, like a
Well,
pin could be
that's what
nice.
I was saying, right? Is that, your smallest item should be a not only smaller in price and size and whatnot, but it should be different in kind in some fashion, right? Because you don't want your cheapest items stepping on your, let's say, your mid-tier main seller,
So
right?
that's what you meant by saying don't have the same print in small, medium, and large, because
Yes.
price-wise, people are more likely to go with the small one because it's more
Yeah.
affordable, and then they're not
Because
going
that way, if
to
someone's like, well, I want to walk away with something, but I have, very little money in my pocket, I've got something for them, but it's like a collection of postcards, and they don't necessarily get to choose which ones. So there's an item of, there's an element of choice, right? That has also changed, as well as the size and
But
the.
since they love all of your work, they don't really care, right? They just know they're going to get
Right.
something
Well, and
cool.
it's specifically for that mentality of I like this artist, not enough to spend the $40 on a specific print, but I want to walk away with something, so I'll walk away with these postcards, right?
There's a story of caution to be had here, and when I say it, you're gonna see it everywhere if you start going to these conventions. It's pricing yourself out, which is, so this happens a lot. People come in, everybody starts selling like the 8, 8.5 by 11 prints or 8 by 10s for $20, $15, whatever at their first show. You see it 100,000 times. Maybe not so much anymore since podcasts like this and conversations like this started happening. But anyway, you don't make a lot of money. But the guy beside you who had like these little postcard prints, it seems like he's selling all day. Well, the postcard, oh, and then everybody's coming up and they're like, $20, I don't know, I don't want to spend $20. And you believe them. And so you go home, and next time you have your little $10, $5 postcards, and you're like, oh, I'm making sales now, because that was the thing. The problem was the price. I need to People like deals, so you start making deals. And then the third convention you go to, you've got your $1 stickers to go for. Well, what are you going to go lower than a dollar? So you see this all the time of people who have these, like the $5 trinkets, and they're never going to grow their business, I think, for that reason. They've sort of priced themselves out.
Well, and we kind of touched on this in our last discussion is that you got to think about how much profit you're making on an item. And the less you make, the more you have to sell of that item to make the same amount of money. So I can sell, one painting for $1,000 or 10 paintings for, $100, or, the further down you go, the more you've got to do.
And
And if you're trying to cover that $2,000 to $3,000 expense just to get in the door, you want to make sure you sell enough that you can cover those costs and hopefully walk away with $3,000 or more on top of it.
Right.
Yes.
Part
And
of the
then
mentality you have to kind of take into this if you're kind of aiming more for the mid to high end at these conventions is that you're not really competing on like number of sales total, right? Like I can have a day where I feel like I have customers kind of few and far between and still come out of that show really well ahead of the game because I've got the high end stuff, right? Like people are buying those items that are, $40 to $150. And,
So I was going to
the
ask you,
person,
what's
even if
the.
you don't think they should sell, you should have them because there's whales out there that will come up and buy it
So what's
eventually.
the most expensive thing that you think is sellable at most of these conventions? What's the high price point?
Bruce, wait, you sell for like a grand?
You
I've
just
sold.
mentioned 40 to 100 bucks, which coming from the fine art world and the, other, that's still really cheap.
Right. The highest end things that I've sold at these have been like a couple $1,000s, but that's tapping into at some of these shows where they have the common, con goer, and they've also got a deep roster of actual collectors, similar to like an ElexCon situation. But like a Dragon Con or Gen Con, you do have some of those collectors, and you've got businesses coming around like game stores looking to decorate their new shop and stuff like that. So there are people with deeper pockets there, and you can certainly move some of those things.
Yeah, the first day of Gen Con, always, and Dragon Con this year, always the first day, I feel terrible for not painting in oils because people will come up and they say, "Oh, is that?" And they're a collector. They're like, "Oh, is that oils?" And you're like, "Oh, no, it's just a print." And they just walk right away.
So again, having something for both demographics helps because you make quite a bit of money off of just those $40 sales or whatnot. And you can also make quite a bit of money off of collectors coming in and buying the couple of originals that you had.
So if you've got $40 items, how much inventory do you try to take to a show? How many prints do you need to have in stock?
Let me pull up my
So
spreadsheet answer.
how I tend to, I guess my philosophy for that is, if I'm trying out a new print, I mean, I have that minimum to work with. I also order my stuff from Elko, so at least five prints, right? Of a particular design that I'm trying out and seeing how it goes. If I think it has more legs than that, I might bring 10. If I think it's going to be like a top seller, then I might bring like 20. And that's for the prints.
But you're also flying to a lot of shows.
I'm also flying to shows, so I'm economizing on my weight. So, I have to be more careful about how much stock that I bring compared to someone who's driving in.
Yeah, I
But
brought.
essentially it kind of like it pares the thing down to the bone of like, okay, here's the essentials that I have to have.
So do
And
you
then I'll
fly
have
with that,
like,
or do you FedEx it ahead, or how do you
I
ship your
fly with
stuff?
it. Yeah,
You do.
I have the prints are sequestered in a box inside of a suitcase. And that's worked just fine for me. And then I'll
The
have like probably somewhere between 12 to 14 print designs that I bring. That's about how much I can typically fit in the amount of space that I've got. And then I've got play mats and other metals and other things with me as well.
I agree with Bruce there. The five to st unless you really think know your audience enough to where you think something's going to sell. Brand new image. I only bring like five, maybe 10. For
You
things that
usually
sell,
never know.
you usually never know, even if you
Yeah.
think it surprises you. But the ones I know sell, I brought at this point my best sellers. I have to bring like I bring 30 or 40, and they will they still sell out. But I'm at my limit at that point. Cool. You know, as far as how many prints I bring to a show in total, and I've got a whole portfolio. But right now I have about 420 prints that I'll be bringing with me to my next show. That's the 12 by 18 size, and then canvases I've got. I can only fit about 15 canvas in my vehicle.
And how many days is that show?
The New bigger World? Shows are 4 days. Yeah. So Gen Con, Dragon Con, Emerald City. These days, Denver. Those are all 4 day shows. Most shows are 3 days.
Most are three.
So when you say you're taking 420 prints, how long is that show? Is that a 4 day show?
I don't base how much I bring on the days of the show because I'm
he just fills driving. His car.
I just fill my car. I just, you know,
that way he's prepared.
I'm prepared. I don't want to.
Flip side is that you don't, you know, you might have something to sell incredibly well and then you're going to be out of it, right? And you don't want to be in that situation either. Yeah. So if you're driving, you have a little bit more flexibility in how much you can kind of overstock things just in case.
Yeah, if I can have the stock, I will have the stock. Because the worst thing that ever happened to me, the print I just showed you, the Dancer, I didn't know if that was going to sell very well at Gen Con, I think. And I only brought, like, I don't want to say 20. I sold it on the first day. And even though I take orders after things sell out, it's not going to sell.
You do well. Lose some sales.
Yeah. You lose some sales.
So let me check my list here. Oh, so... we talked about the costs up front. So do most of these shows give you the table and you have to, it varies show to show as to what you put on and around the table, or are there any where you have to bring a table as well? Or
It depends on the show. There definitely are some where you have to bring the table. Typically when you're starting out though, you might be starting out in Artist Alley. Artist Alley always comes with like a 6 foot table that you get. When you start doing exhibitor, like vendor spaces, like 10 by 10s and so on. Yeah, full-size booths. Some shows provide tables. You know, like, for example, I'll do a corner 10 by 10 at any show that I'm thinking about doing as a preference, right? That's kind of like a nice sweet spot. And I've got some shows where they provide two tables for that. I've got some shows where they provide one table for that, and Reed Pop these days has decided that they're providing no tables for their biggest shows like Emerald City and New York Comic Con. If you do New York Comic Con as a vendor, you're spending literally like $2,000 to $3,000 on a 10 by 10 slab of concrete with no table, no chairs, no waste basket, nothing.
So then that's more that you've got to somehow either take with you,
typically,
or rent when you get there?
Yes. Typically, the convention itself has this sort of stuff, so you can rent chairs and tables and all the rest of that, and it's an added expense. And of course, since they're the easiest supplier, then they will ratchet up their rates. I would suggest...
I'm shocked. Really?
Now you're going to these shows with a car... So keep in mind that you can always go over to a Home Depot and you can get a table if you don't have one, if you're not bringing one.
I've got a couple in my garage. I'm just waiting.
Yeah.
To go.
Yeah. So, holding tables. Early on, I had a few situations. Of course, I was flying into shows where I needed to go out and Uber out to like a Home Depot. And then I guess the nice thing about a Home Depot is you can return it at the end of the weekend and they're going to take it back, no questions asked, as long as you've got the credit card you purchased it on. Yeah. So someone working with very little finances might want to consider something like that. But yeah, most of us who've been doing it a while have tables to spare at home.
I've often had to stack boxes to try and make more table space for myself because... They don't always give you the table you think you're going to get.
Right. One thing that I've done at times is I'll have like some foam board or something, attach it to the top of one of my suitcases, and put the tablecloth over that on the end of my table, and I can get an extra foot or so of space. Because when you're doing one of these shows, like say Gen Con, every additional foot of space that you've got counts.
So lighting, I know some shows you can rent lighting from them. Do you recommend any special lighting to exhibit your work, or just take whatever you can get lighting wise?
Most people in our community have switched over to this, what is it, Silicone Lightworks? What is it called?
Something like that. I haven't switched over myself, just again because I'm flying to shows and usually don't have the weight and space to deal with it, but that is the optimal kind
So
of situation, so you get
still
that gallery look.
they have the best part about them is that they break down and they're rechargeable and they fit into a case like, the size of your torso. And but that's for people who are flying to shows. Annie and Justin Gerard taught me this trick. Because they drive to most of their shows. I asked them, I was like, "Oh, your lighting looks so good. What do you guys use?" And they're like, "Oh, you just go get the clamp desk lights from Walmart, and those work just fine. And they usually come with bulbs." So even whenever I was traveling to shows, I would just go buy the like $5 lamps and then give them away, which Bruce does with his banners. So
Yeah, so sometimes, again, because I'm flying to a lot of my shows, because I'm located out near Seattle, and that sharply limits how much is within drivable range, right? So one of the things that I've had to do at a lot of shows is, so the most basic kind of a backdrop you can have is like a photo backdrop with banners hanging off of it, right? And what I discovered is that it was far more expensive to have a third item of luggage that I'm bringing two ways from a show than just having Amazon deliver a fresh backdrop, bring the banners with me, set up, and then I've got these things stashed away in the garages of friends and family all over the country now, but in some cases I don't have that, in which case at the end of the show, I'll look around and see if there's someone who looks like they could use it and donate it to another con artist.
So when you're talking about some of these backdrops and banners and whatnot, I think Alan, you mentioned you've got a wall system that you use and that you recommend. Can you give me the info again on what
So
company
these are
you're
the
working with?
two other ones. This was my setup. It's at Lilac City Comic Con in Spokane. And on the right side, you can see the photo backdrop with the banner hanging from it. And on the left side, you can see the that's a Flourish panel, which is something that you can order online, which is like kind of a mesh that's pulled taut between these aluminum or steel bars, whatever those are, very heavy.
So that's all
So
stuff you provide, the framing.
that stuff, yeah, that's all stuff that I provide.
Flourish panels are good. You can see the banners he was talking about. But I didn't realize I muted myself to look this up. I was talking. But the Flourish panels are great because they break down. They're mesh walls. They roll up. But man, are they heavy.
Yeah, you can break them down and fit them into a ski bag, but boy, I wouldn't want to lug that onto a plane even if they let me.
Yeah, I did it. It's not fun. The walls that I use, and I found that when I started using these, even over banners and panels, my sales skyrocketed. They're called Pro Panels. I'll just pull them up. They
They
look
look
like
th
gallery walls
yeah,
because they
they
kind of
look
are
very
gallery
nice.
walls. They look really nice, and my stuff's kind of classical looking, so it just kind of matches the theme I'm going for. The thing I like most about them, I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. The thing I like most about them is A, they break down, so these are the full size ones, and you can get them to break down in all these different sorts. B, you can just Velcro things right onto them. That's what I like. So,
So if you're Velcroing, is there, what's the weight limit to have something hold on Velcro?
you want to put them in an arrangement where they're going to, they're very flimsy and they'll blow over way too easily. Why won't this minimize? They'll blow over way too easily. So you have to put them in like some form of a V or even like a zigzag.
Well, and you saw some examples there where they had created kind of like a C, but they had a support thing across the top also to help brace
the weight
them.
Limit, as long as they're in some sort of brace, and you can actually order legs for them, but they're kind of chunky. They've been able to hold all of my, even my 20 by 30 full backed canvases framed. So
I guess that was my question.
Well, he was
more
curious
what
about
the
Velcro
hold.
Yeah, industrial strength Velcro can hold originals if you want. I've seen people do it.
The industrial strength Velcro is usually too close together. It's meant to attach to the hook system that they send, not meant to attach to the kind of looser one on the pro panels. I learned this the hard way. Because I got the industrial strength one mm-hmm. that you see all the time, and all my canvases fell down and were heavily damaged. I think it's Hansen hooks makes
the
best
product. Yeah,
they've
got hooks that can hook to the top of the pro panel too. I just ordered some of those for my next show because I've got a tension banner stand that I'm gonna try out at this next one this week. So that's another way. So you've got like tension wire that's
Hansen hooks
to
actually Velcro on, and the Velcro is extremely strong. They tell you up to 100, 300, 100 something pounds.
Oh, I'm talking about something else then. Yeah, they also sell like these kind of like wire hook thing systems that'll hook onto the top of the pro panel, and then you can
like
attach further hooks along the line down and attach your valuable items onto that.
Yeah, there's gallery setups for fine art that are similar to that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you are going to one of these shows, and it's primarily a, you know, sci-fi fantasy kind of show, how much can you get away with promoting or selling stuff that isn't overtly sci-fi fantasy? And again, Alan kind of goes back to the direction you're pushing some of your work that maybe doesn't have as, you're producing stuff as mm-hmm. fine art that doesn't have a client behind it that's hardcore fantasy, say.
Well,
does anybody say to you, no, that doesn't belong here?
I don't think that anyone's going to say this doesn't belong here. Like, I've definitely sold stuff that was more just kind of landscapey and not necessarily very fantasy or whatever. For one thing, at conventions, one demographic to think about that is sometimes overlooked is the convention spouse, the person who's not as into, you know, comic books, fantasy, gaming, whatever, but they're along for the ride mm-hmm. and they spot something that they'd like to hang up in their house, and something that's couch hangable and it works fine for mixed company, but it's from a fantasy artist, so, you know, like maybe they can get buy-in from both spouses to hang this thing up over their couch.
That's
so,
when sales started to skyrocket, when I
yeah,
started
it can really work out
art. Yeah.
And it sometimes pays to be the one who stands out as not the same as what everyone else is bringing to the convention. So, you know, being the one person who's selling something that's, you know, beautiful, atmospheric work or whatever, that like maybe has like in its lighting or its color choices or something that feels a little bit like magical realist, but isn't quite fantasy, can fit in perfectly well at one
things
of these
like
shows.
A Gen Con might be a little tougher because it is you know very fantasy based, but the not that much tougher. The ones that like a Planet City Comic Con, where it's sort of you know, see what sticks, they don't mind at all. I've been beside things and seen things that you really wouldn't expect to see at a convention at all. I saw a guy selling furniture.
No dragons painted on the.
Well, it was handmade furniture, but I didn't see any dragons. I've seen.
So you guys kind of touched on some of the products that you try to sell, originals, prints, framed versus unframed. You got the plastic sleeves. You kind of talked price points. Anything you want to clarify about types of merchandise that sells well, something that somebody might want to focus on if it's their first convention and they're just getting started, that is kind of a good way to enter into this world.
Yeah, this goes along with our last podcast. I Bruce's might be the exact same. Whatever you do after listening to this, do not go out and buy pro panels, 420 prints, and $500 canvases and get a Gen Con booth. Do not do it unless you're
Don't.
extremely confident and certain you're
You
going to
already
make
have that
those
hundred
sales.
thousand followers on
You
social
know,
media.
if you're a Trustafarian and you've got money coming from your family that is going to keep you in house and home, whether or not you have a total bust out, then sure, go nuts. But for
What's
most
the
of
safe
us,
approach then for somebody who's starting out and they'd have no idea whether they're going to sell or have a following? What would you recommend to them?
I would say don't overinvest in too many of any given print. Like, bring a modest selection, maybe consider starting off with some conventions that are not charging an arm and a leg for a booth, because there are plenty of those out there.
Be willing to go, do not go into it thinking about sales at all. Make the sales secondary and treat it like a learning experience. Treat it like an investment to learn about your business, because your first convention's not going to be a skyrocket. Maybe it will. I haven't seen a lot of people that it is, unless you're already famous. But over and over again, I see people who have jumped into the convention scene and they're not making sales and they're downtrodden, and all you want to do is go up and tell them it's okay. You see it a lot, and it's because they've over invested, or their expectations were not were
Yeah,
kind of out of the
and
park.
if possible, have, like go in a situation where you have a bit of money saved up, so if this convention doesn't go well, you're not going to be entering the doom spiral. Like, I mean, that was my approach in general to re-engaging with my art career after 6 years, or actually it was more like 8 years away from it, because I was teaching for a while, and I came back to it having paid off my school loans, and I had a good amount of savings in the tank, so I was able to kind of approach it like Alan's saying, is like, okay, I'm investing in myself. First convention, my total investment was like $1,000, including all
Yes.
the merch that I bought, and the backdrop, and the table itself, and it was in Seattle, where I was living at the time, so my travel costs and accommodation were, basically zero.
Yeah, the you're you know you've got an income, so 2 grand for a learning experience, and you'll probably make the 2 grand back. May not be tough for you, but we put 2 grand as our price, our cost. You could very easily get that to the price of a booth, splitting up an Airbnb or a hotel, and eating hot dogs off the street. So,
Well, hopefully not right off the street. I don't want to go that low.
and I'm gonna add, stand up.
Do
Do not sit down at your booth.
not sit down.
Get
Stand
some.
up and engage.
Yep.
How many hours a day do you usually have to be at your booth at most of these conventions?
It's a 9-hour day, usually.
Yeah, nine. I'd say it goes from what, 10 to 7, so
Ten
yeah,
to
nine
seven is
hours.
pretty typical.
The worst one I ever did was, what was Rose City? It was like
Oh,
almost
Rose City,
nine to
the,
nine. It
well,
was insane.
no, because
Nine
what
days.
Rose City does is the first day, it's a Friday, and the show opens at 1 p.m. and then they're running until like 9. So because they're starting late, they're also ending late on that day, and that's a rough one. You're very, like, I'm always famished by the time I get out, so I always have my family pick up some great Lebanese food from this place that I love and have it like in the car so I can begin
So
scarfing
the
the second I
mats,
get in my seat.
the mats you can stand on are really
When
great.
I was in
Yes.
college, I learned how to airbrush from my freshman roommate, and I went and told my parents I wanted to start doing airbrush t-shirts at fairs and festivals. And so I kind of had that experience of, but there it was, you'd get in at whatever, 10 in the morning, and you'd work until 2 a.m. when the beer tents closed. And you had the drunks coming out and talking to you about your art, and then go home and have to clean the airbrushes and get to bed and get up the next day and do it. So those were really long days. But I learned from there, number one, it was good to have a good booth set up. And number two, that it was good to have a helper.
Yes. Helpers,
Because
yeah.
then one of you can stop and go to the bathroom or get food or whatever while the other one's there. So what's your take? I mean, if you're doing, say, what was it, 7 hours? 7 or 8? 9?
Hours. Really,
Do you try
optimally.
to have somebody with you to take breaks and go get a meal, or do you just like, okay, I'm going to eat a big meal before or after, and I'm just going to run straight through and have some
Mean,
snacks there?
optimally, before we move on to the food situation, optimally, I would say for your own health, you're going to want to have a plush mat thing to stand on, like the line cooks have. Like that's what I bring to any show that I at least I can drive to. Have an assistant if possible, because then even just the matter of like always having someone standing at attention to get people. One person can be sitting and you can just kind of like prairie dog back and forth. And that's
So
going to
one chair
save.
is enough. Two people, one chair.
Well, they usually most of these places provide 2 chairs,
Let's give one of the chairs
but
away. So,
you can certainly get away with 1 chair and then yeah, have take turns sitting so that you're not destroying your back doing this thing.
Bruce and a lot of people offer, free. Usually, your booth comes with 2 passes. If you don't have a wife like me, I think Bruce usually offers a free admission to the convention if somebody helps him out. Is that right?
Yeah, so typically, I mean, I'll reach out late earlier in the year and say, hey, does anyone want to shadow me at a convention? And I can provide the badge, I can, pay for your parking and pay for your food and so on. So in situations like that, like it's not have hiring on a full assistant. People also, like once you get to the point where you're actually making a good amount of money, you can just hire someone to help you. And I do know plenty of people who do that as well. So there's different kind of tiers of quid pro quo, right, that you can potentially offer in these situations.
It
And
seemed like at Dragon Con, I saw a number of top tier artists sitting there by themselves with no apparent helpers, and
not recommended.
not recommend.
Now,
But
Dragon
you
Con, you
can
can
do it,
kind of
but
get
don't.
away with it just because they make an extra effort to take care of their artists and they send their volunteers around to say, hey, do you need water? Do you need a bathroom break? Like, we'll watch your booth for a second while
Wow.
you do that. Like,
Okay.
most places aren't going to provide that service like they do. So that might also be one reason why you saw relatively more people sitting by themselves and managing to do so. But
And
I don't
some
know that
people
I'd
don't take
recommend it.
conventions as seriously is probably the wrong word, but when they were like Todd, when Todd Lockwood was coming up, conventions were more of a, you make some sales, you make some contacts, and you hang out and party with other artists. I think now the mindset is much more business focused, and some
Like you can
people
earn serious money and
serious
often
money.
more money from the conventions than from the freelance. So,
Right.
yeah.
But I think a lot of the people that have been doing this for years, before that was more of the norm, are just they don't want to do it. They want to hang out, and having an assistant's not always part of that. And if
So
you're married, you're right. So you're
yeah, that's it's not really my wife's thing. So
well,
she
Sarah
would
would
be
not.
happy to travel with me and then go off and do her own thing, but to sit there at the booth with me, I don't think.
Yeah.
Now my son is another story. He's like, yeah,
Sure.
Dad, if you want to do conventions, I will definitely go with you. Because
There
when I
you
go to
go.
conventions now,
Bingo.
just to visit and check them out, Zach's the one who comes with me, and he helps me drive and keep me awake. And
Yeah.
but we get our tickets and we get in the door and then we just split and go our own directions. And we don't try to keep tabs on each other. It's like, you go do
That's
your thing, I'll go
perfect.
do mine. We'll check in for dinner.
And you could
But yeah, he said he'd be help be willing to help me out.
Offer him something. I mean, I'm not telling you, don't tell him this, but you could offer him 10% or something if it if it's something he really...
Probably if I just pay for the ticket in and his hotel and food, he'd be like, I'm there. But I'll have to negotiate with him.
When I was Todd's assistant, he always gave me a percent, but he didn't pay for my hotel, so it kind of canceled out.
Depends how sustain, how many events are you going to end up doing a year, and how sustainable do you want the arrangement to be long term, right? Or are you looking for a professional assistant at some point? Yeah. So
I mean, he's got his own life and career, and he'd have to take time off work to go.
So those are the things to consider as far as also what the appropriate quid pro quo ends up being in any given situation.
How are we doing on time, Alan?
I probably have to. It's probably a good point. I mean, if you got anything else, any last thoughts, that would be good.
I guess one last question, or a couple if we've got time for it. Booth arrangement. Do you like having a table between you and your buyers? Or I see some people who did the kind of three side.
Do not do the walk in. I wish we could have. The best way to do this would be like invisibly. We walk around a convention and tell you what not to do. The walk in is a trap. Nobody wants to come into your space, right? They feel uncomfortable.
Basically, like there are some scenarios where you can make it work, but essentially you'd have to have a very large booth in order to make it not feel claustrophobic for people. So typically, you want to arrange it the other way, where you're behind the table and you're trying to maximize your facing space. Hence why the corner booth is always the best option there. Okay. You've got more lines of sight to your work. And
is there
more...
a premium to pay for the corner space?
Yes. Oh,
yes.
Yeah. I assume so.
And it's some conventions like Planet City. I always get some conventions like that. You can get two booths. I always get two booths.
Right. You can do two in lines, and that also creates more sight lines and more space and a bigger presence, which all help.
So to wrap up, how do you take payment?
Square Reader.
Square Reader.
Do you take like Apple Pay and PayPal and things like that?
Yeah. Well, Square Reader takes Apple Pay, which is nice. You mean like if somebody wants to PayPal me $40? I've done that. I've done Venmo and
PayPal. My current situation is I have like the little doohickey that you slide the credit card through, so I'm actually not able to take Apple Pay at the moment for that reason. So when people are like, oh man, I absolutely have to do contactless payment, I'm like, well, can you do Venmo or PayPal? And that's always worked out.
I
like things simple, and I like to have the least number of things I have to charge in at the end of the night. Also,
it lasts me like two shows. It's great. And I don't do shows like you do.
Square that you're talking about?
Yeah, he's talking about reader. A contactless different kinds. Square
they,
reader.
They make the little one, little small one about this big that just slots in. They make a Bluetooth one, which is what I'm talking about. It's about this big, but it's wireless, where things can tap. And then the creme de la creme, Mark Poole's got this set up. I really love it, where it's actually like a big hunking console that is your entire point of sale. And so you control it from your phone, and then they see everything happening on the other side of the table. Really like that. Super professional. Costs like $300-something, doesn't it?
Actually, that's not as bad as I thought.
Yeah, it's
you got to make sure you got the business before you invest in that. Do you ever have anybody try to write checks or anything like that anymore? No. Cash? No checks?
Lots of cash. Cash is fine. But yeah, no checks.
Good to have the ability to make change then.
Yeah, I would. I forget every single time, but I often... if I do remember, we'll at least have $100 in different types of change.
Yeah, I bring $100 in a mix of ones, fives, tens, and just have that as change. Also, you can arrange your pricing to minimize the amount of change. So definitely do not do any kind of pricing that involves coins. You don't want to have to deal with coins at all. Optimally, you don't want to have to deal with ones at all, even. So, like, for most types of things that you're probably going to be dealing with coming in initially, you can price everything in fives and tens and just run with that.
What about taxes?
As a magic artist, well, just to finish this thought, as a magic artist, I now have to deal with signatures. So now ones are a thing that I have to deal with, unfortunately.
Taxes.
Sales tax, do you have to collect that?
Square's great because you can work it into
Yeah.
the little system there.
You
And do you
input
want to
it.
take, yeah, you
Yeah.
want to take the sales tax of wherever you're at.
And every state, of course, is different.
It's
So
different.
that is a headache. You end up having to deal with,
It's a
potentially
huge
as much
headache.
as 50 different systems for remitting your sales tax and at different times of year and all the rest of it.
Sales tax
My
is
my
always before the first. At least I always, that's what I always heard. So I always file mine before the first.
before the first of what?
Oh, sorry. I mean, yeah, the new year.
The
It's
next
not
year.
the normal tax.
It depends. Like, for example, I believe Georgia and Utah, for example, like you pretty much remit the money right after the show. There's also some states that don't have sales tax. Like I do a show in Portland, and Portland has like a, I don't know, it's like a $20 a day fee as a vendor instead of a sales tax. So it varies. Every state's different.
I missed the tax deadline. I forgot for Gen Con 1 year, and they were
Indiana will
like,
get on your case, yeah.
Indiana. Well, it's all I learned. It's all automated, but they were like, according to our records,
Yeah.
because the address is the convention address, which is
Yeah.
downtown. They're like, according to our records, businesses in this area usually pay us $50,000 in tax.
Yeah.
So they sent me a bill for $50,000. I was like,
Because
what the hell?
it's the average, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they send, yeah, if you forget to pay, states like, I mean, Indiana and Arizona were the ones that where I dealt with this kind of a system where they'll send an estimated tax and then you have to fill out their paperwork and say, no, this is actually how much tax I owe you guys. Sorry for forgetting.
I had a strange one. It's a neat story. Tupelo, which is just the town, what, 2 hours, 3 hours from me, tried a local convention. It went all right. It was a 2 day show, Saturday, Sunday. I made $1,000 in profit. Not bad for a weekend. Something close. I probably won't return, but there's a guy that came around at the very end of the show, and he said, while I'm trying to like break my stuff down, and he's like, hey, what'd you make in sales? And I was like, oh, I did pretty great. He's like, no, how much did you make? I have to do the taxes. And I was like, oh, okay. So I told him, and he comes back around and he's like, okay, you owe me. And he told me how much I owed him. And I was like, what? And he was like, yeah, you pay me, and then I file the taxes for you. And
That sounds like a
I was like,
scam.
and he really worked for them. I mean, this is really how they do it. I saw everybody giving the guy money, and I'm like, listen, man, I'm sorry, but I'm not giving you any money. I'll file my own taxes. Thank you.
That's
He seemed really offended. I don't even know if they've
I'm
had any.
thinking, well, there's a good scam to go to all the other conventions and be like, I'm here to collect your sales tax.
I'm the tax collector.
Hand it over. Oh, well. I think that covers it for now. Obviously, if I have any other in-depth questions, if I try to get into conventions next year, I will just, harass you
Yes,
mercilessly
reach
until
out.
you give me other information I need.
100%. Yeah, I'll send you all the vendors we use.
I
Bruce will
appreciate it.
too.
You guys are great.
Anyway,
Fun.
happy to help.
Total of like 3 hours of chat today. It's nice to be able to talk to other artists. I don't get to do this a lot. So thank you very much for having me on the podcast, letting me do a Q&A with you.
Our
Both
pleasure.
directions.
Thank you.
Thanks
Yeah,
for
that's why we started this, so we can talk to people, because we're usually in our goblin caves, right? Yeah, I hope you do more episodes of this podcast. It was fun.
I'm sure we can find other things to talk about. No problem.
All right. Thanks again, Ron.
Thank you. Take care, guys.